Hey guys, sorry for the hiccups. I'm usually late with these kinds of things. So I'm gonna be talking about, well, what I wanted to be talking about in the first place was re-implementing React. So I went back to the first ever commit of React in 2013. Well, no, the first ever public commit of React in 2013. Turns out that's already 130-something thousand lines of code. So that's still out of GPT-4's latest context size. I won't be re-implementing React today in half an hour. What I will be talking about instead is fundamentals and abstractions, like where does the web come from, where do web frameworks come from, and how everything kind of builds on top of the previous thing, and how progress happens. So I hope you don't mind going against the constant flow of new web development paradigms, as we'll explore a brief history of the web, a short primer on the primitives, and an exploration of an ever-increasing consumer demands on UX, interactivity, speed, feedback, graceful error handling, like cross-browser compatibility, and basically everything the world can throw at us, developers, because what can happen is going to happen, and things are not always going to work out. So I'm Chris. Hi. I've been writing software since, I don't know, like I started when I was 14. I wrote really, really silly games in Visual Basic, which is just ridiculous. Don't do that. But then I went into mobile development, mostly on the native side, for Android, then for, through React Native for iOS as well. And then I went into web development, which I did try before, but JS in the 2010s was just terrible. I don't wish that on anyone. So yeah, I'm coming from native, so getting to know how the web basically developed over time and how everything that we know today came to be was definitely an interesting journey that that we are gonna explore in the next 25 minutes. So where did we come from? Well, this is probably an AI-generated image. I don't know if the caveman had a MacBook. But yeah, the early web, it started way back in 1991, the first ever website, info.cern.ch. This is actually still online. You can see that. It's a really, really simple website, white background, black text, really, really fast click through. Like, I don't know. They must have some really nice build of React on there so that it's so fast. There's also Mosaic, the first browser in 1993. And then 1994, the URL, the Uniform Resource Locator came out. I don't know what they did before they had URLs. Probably IPs, but yeah. And then came Netscape Navigator. This was the first big innovator in the space. And after that came Internet Explorer from Microsoft. These basically took whatever came from the server and rendered it in a certain way. And they basically started a war on each other, which one can do more with the data that's being transferred over the internet. So, 1995, JavaScript. So some guy at Netscape probably asked, can we make these buttons jump around the whole page? And the other guy said, sure, why not? So they made the predecessor of JavaScript in Netscape, which Microsoft basically reverse engineered for their browser, the Internet Explorer. And then the IE also came out with CSS support a year later. And this was basically a long back and forth between them until Firefox came along. Yeah, so after JavaScript, you were able to do so many pretty things like these. I actually wanted to embed an iframe here, but this website is so modern that this actually employs content security policy, so I couldn't do the iframe version. So yeah, how do you get data from a server to the client? Well, we have the client, we have the server. Let's just say I want to get this resource. this is basically everything that HTTP was at first. Well, the point 9, this came later, because when they did HTTP version 1, they wanted to be able to version it. So for identification purposes, they said, like, let's make this HTTP 0.9. This is literally the client telling the server in plain text, I want to get this resource. The server says, this resource. This is basically an ASCII chunk that is being sent over the network so the client can read it sequentially. And this was a big thing for HTTP, because in 1.0, they rethought everything, kind of. Well, not really, because get potato is still there. But they added versioning, so the interpreter now knows what it's supposed to look for in these fields. And they also added headers. You can see user agent, mosaic. And now it tells the server, I want this resource, I'm using this HTTP version, and this user agent was important because there were so many differences between browsers that the server needed to handle these differences itself. So you couldn't write polyfills in JavaScript and all that kind of stuff. That came later. And then the server responds with a status code that was introduced in 1.0 with other headers. It also tells the client what the content type is, and then just the content. Like, this is literally, if you open your proxy, man-in-the-middle proxy, whatever, on your laptop, this is what you're going to see on the request and response on the raw field. So yeah, I also wanted to talk a little bit about 1.0. Sorry, let me just find that in my notes. Because HTTP 1.0 introduced, on top of these concepts, control sequences. Like, it introduced reusable connections pipelining, which means you don't have to wait for a connection to go through and then request a new resource. You can just send the request for an HTML. You get everything that's in it, like the resource pointers, and then you request everything all at once. Also, based on the headers, HTTP 1.1 introduced the cache control, content negotiation. Like, you can request for HTML, you can request for JSON, you can request for text, whatever. You can accept language. The accept language header was introduced with 1.1. And then encryption was implemented by Netscape. This was SSL 1.0. This never actually publicly released. But SSL 2.0 later became standardized and became TLS itself, which we already know today as HTTPS and the certificates and all that stuff. So yeah, other security features are also built on this model, where you have these headers like course and CSP. Basically, what these are is just special headers telling your browser what to do in certain cases and what not to do in certain cases. So yeah, these can be quite a head scratcher in local or remote development, or whenever when you start a project and like, hey, course error. Hey, you cannot embed this iframe like the one before, when I tried before. Well, yeah, this is where this came from. Once you understand how these headers work, how the server tells the client how to ask for what it can do and what it should be able to do, you'll be able to understand much easier how these client protection protocols, not really security, but client protection protocols, and the security protocols themselves work, and how you can actually work and implement this properly with your application. And it's sleeping. So yeah, these things, it's gonna come back, I hope. So these things are like HTML, CSS, JavaScript, HTTP. For like 10 years, or 15, more like 15, or more like, I don't know, it's like 34 years now, everybody implements it slightly differently when there are gaps in how we implement these things. So if we don't know what to do when a certain, like when you add a string and a number in JavaScript, Netscape is going to say, let's add it. The other one is going to say, let's break it. Like, this is an error. You can't do that. But what tends to happen is a single solution starts to emerge, everybody starts to kind of gravitate towards that. Well, most of the industry starts to gravitate towards that, because at this time, it's a pretty small industry, so to say. Not a lot of people know how to do this. Not a lot of people care. And this way, these standards can really just emerge from usage. But then standards bodies emerge as well, because there is a need for them. Because otherwise, how are you going to get Microsoft and other big players to do the same thing? Because they do want to lock people into their own thing that they poured a lot of money into. So that's when the HTML standards, HTTP standards, TLS, and all that kind of stuff came from. And yeah, the early resources were not much more than just files, like the HTML file, the WAV file for audio, the JPEG or PNG or whatever they had for images back then. It was just a static list of all that. And then the server basically took those files from the file system and served it to you through HTTP, as we saw before. Oh yeah, just a side note, what does HTTP mean? It's basically hypertext transfer protocol. What is hypertext? Hypertext is nonlinear text, which is basically everything that you use today, like sound files, images, all that kinds of stuff. They can be nonlinear. I really should have turned off standby. So all that can be nonlinear in nature, and the protocol really doesn't care. That's why it's so flexible, and that's why so much stuff has been built up on it. And then once, eventually, a guy, Danish-Canadian dude, Rasmus Lerdorf, I think I pronounced it wrong, he created PHP to maintain his own personal homepage. He was born in 1968, by the way, so he's not that old. And he released it to the public in 1995, and that became personal homepage, PHP. It's not PHP today. I think it's more like PHP is hypertext programming or something like that. I don't know. I don't remember. But it was personal homepage at first. And would you look at that? This looks a lot like JSX if you imagine some JavaScript around it, right? Like, this is almost the curly question mark, the other, ampersand or dollar, whatever. So this was basically the early templating that we had. And then from PHP, we moved on to .NET, to Java, to whatever. By the way, you could actually just write web servers in shell files or bat scripts or whatever. Like, literally, it doesn't have to be anything special. You just send back text. But then, based on this, there was all of these advancements, and much more that were actually omitted, because we don't have time to list everything. They paved the way through for a very explosive expansion on this. A lot of companies started to basically feel the fear of missing out. Because if they weren't on the web, they were missing out on a gigantic marketing opportunity, on a gigantic market with an ever-increasing amount of clients that are on there. So in 1999, AJAX, XML HTTP request came, which basically marked the client side is the king era. Well, it's not really, but so it basically started the whole let's move everything to the client movement. Because with AJAX XML HTTP request, you can actually send the request from a button and you don't need to reload the whole page. Up until that point, you had to do that if you wanted to change something as a response to some request. And then jQuery gained a lot of popularity. In 2000, REST, or representational state transfer, was proposed. This is an HTTP server callable from standard web libraries and tools. In 2004, Opera actually implemented server-sent events. You might know them today as server pushes or all that. Well, server sentiment still exists. It's basically the client doesn't have to request every resource. The server can send the resource as well. And this exists for like almost 20 years now. And we're just going back to that. And then in 2006, jQuery came. 2007, HTML5 started to emerge as a response to the very basic HTML tags not being sufficient for a lot of use cases. And then this started a much more hardcore standardization process in the web era with a much, much bigger market. A lot of consumers, a lot of developers came in. And 2012, the HTML5 reached candidate recommendation status, which is pretty cool. That was actually when most of the browsers started supporting HTML5. Like at that time, around 2012, there was a game, I don't know if anyone played it, from Mozilla, which was HTML5 based, and it's called Browser Quest. It's an RPG game. It's literally client-side JavaScript running via Node. Sorry, client-side JavaScript and then server-side JavaScript running via Node using WebSockets that were also invented. Well, yeah, WebSockets were implemented in 2010. And yeah, these kickstarted a growing bias towards more work on the client side for highly, thank you, interaction-intensive apps. And what followed were a lot of experiments. So a lot of experiments into what can we do on the client. Steve Jobs famously bashed Adobe Flash, for example. Flash was one of these technologies that offered an app-like interactivity on the client's browser. This was, come on, we're still here. So yeah, this was an interesting time. Like if you ever wrote Flash or tried to program a Flash game or something like that, you might know that it was not pretty, it was not easy. And with the standardization of HTML5 and ES5 emerging as a better JavaScript standard that works much better across browsers and has a wide scale support, it's still not perfect, but it's really good compared to what we had back then, the Java server pages or Flash. So jQuery became huge. 2010, Jeremy Ashkenaz released the Backbone.js. This was the first framework that was aimed at creating single page applications. And that looked cool. Like you can attach listeners to elements. You can attach basically different actions to your buttons. You can send forms, but don't really reload the whole page. You can do client-side interactivity with the backend and do all the back and forth that I talked about earlier. But eventually, what tends to happen is what you don't really see in modern apps, in modern SBAs or MPAs, is that it becomes a huge mess. Like everywhere on every element, there's some listener, there's something, there's some binding. There's a ton of bindings that you don't even know where they go. Like selectors running God knows what. So these became a gigantic pain in the ass. And Backbone was an answer to that. Backbone did not actually require jQuery, but it did use jQuery to be able to do a lot more client-side interactivity. So that was kind of like a progressive enhancement project. So you could use Backbone to build the backbone of your web app, and then you could use jQuery to sparkle in some more of that interactivity. So around the same time, what? What did you do? Adam Arbons and Mishko Havery created AngularJS. That was still 2010. AngularJS was the first fully spec'd out, fully kitted, hardcore single page application driving framework. And that took everything from the backend and everything from backend that was not necessarily tied to the backend and moved it to the front end. So now your front end can run your whole application. It just needs the backend to I don't know, sit there and take the data. And then the guy was hired by Google, and then Google basically swallowed that project and gave it its own life. I think there's one more or two, that's fine. AngularJS's main feature was two-way data binding. So when I say echo hello world here, Angular can say, you have a model here, which is, I don't know, like a greeting object. And the greeting object has a field. And that field can bind into this H1 or a span in here. And that two-way binding ensures that you can have JavaScript objects without writing all the binding code. And you can operate on those JavaScript objects without having to write the binding code. It's going to update the DOM, which is, it doesn't seem too big at first, but if you think about it, if you try to write the whole thing in jQuery, you have to think about, where is this element? What does this element do? Is there any element like that that my selector would match? And how would I know that? With Angular, these became a lot simpler, because the two-way binding works two ways. You have your object, and your object notifies the DOM elements and like basically everywhere. And that's pretty cool. And that's what Angular was first in. But yeah, AngularJS in that fashion was deprecated a while ago. But anyways, I'm just gonna pull it back later. So this was when the actual web pages started to transition into being web apps themselves. And this, like, for me personally, this looks a lot like, let's bring mobile applications to our browser. Like, the browser became an application platform, and I think this is very well signaled by Google, for example, having their Chromebooks run Chromium OS, which is based on their browser, Chrome. And there was also Mozilla's smartphone, which ran Firefox Mobile, which was a browser-based mobile operating system. Knockout was another framework that provided a solution to bidirectional data binding, but it did not attract as many people as Angular, and I guess that was kind of due to Google's influence as well. But then React came out from Facebook in 2013. They've been using it since 2011 for their timeline, their homepage. What they did solve with that is that if you look at your Facebook homepage, there's tons of controls in there. There's fields, there's buttons, there's links, there's everything. You don't want to reload everything every single time. And that's why Facebook was like, hey, let's do something about it. Let's ship everything to the client and let the client handle this. And that's kind of where React came from, but it also brought in a new model to think about the web, or actually UI development itself. In the sense that the DOM, if you look at the browser source code for Chromium, for example, the DOM is just a shadow DOM itself. So the document object model actually goes down and gets interpreted by C++ code and C and all that good stuff, and then assembly and then machine code. But then they have another layer on top of it, which is going to be the shadow DOM or virtual DOM or whatever they want to call it. And that was what Facebook did with React. They had this alternative layer on top of the DOM, because when you work with JavaScript objects, it's really, really, really fast. Because JavaScript can and does actually run on C++ code. If you look at the V8 engine source, this is pretty cool that you can see how the type coercion actually happens in a language that doesn't play well with adding strings and numbers together. Yeah. Sorry, do you have some water? And using this virtual model, they were able to quickly run through changes to that data object, diff everything, see what needs to be changed on the actual DOM side. And when the DOM is changed, that's expensive, because that's actually when we tell the browser, hey, do something. And then the browser is going to do its thing, talk to the hardware, talk to the GPU, talk to the renderer, everything. And if we can save some time on that, we can save a lot of time for the user experience. Thank you. So there are also other questions and answers these frameworks provide, like how do we break the UI apart? If you have a HTML, that's an HTML file. That's gigantic. If you have something like Facebook, you want to have a lot of things in there. How do you break that up? You don't want to have 10,000 lines of code in a single file. Well, most of these frameworks opted to be able to use components, and this is something that we also are moving towards with the web standards today, with web components. They can be instantiated, and web components became a standard in the browsers themselves. So this is something that we can thank the front-end frameworks for. How do we load the data into the UI? With jQuery, you can send AJAX requests, select the item that you want to load it into, and then set the inner HTML or the text element or whatever. With React, for example, we have async await now. You can just await the data and then display it, like set it somewhere to the data object that you have, and that data object, the virtual DOM, is going to update the actual DOM. How do we navigate around? Well, links and forms. Like, these are the only two elements in the HTML standard that actually let you navigate. Like, there's nothing else. You can look it up. So in HTML, you have links and you have forms. Forms have actions. Actions need to run a post request. And that's how you are able to push the location from one place to the other. But you can actually now access the browser history API, which is a new thing, well, kind of new thing. And there's also a lot more things that you can do with JavaScript, but from plain HTML, you can use links and forms. For remote data update, React says, let's use server actions. That's something that we can do now. You just write some JavaScript that's going to run on the server, that's going to update the data in your service, it's going to return something. It's kind of like if your PHP file, if your PHP, if I had HTML, sent a form, and then that form that received some data, saved it to the server, and then gave you back something. That's basically a server action. Almost everything is a server action if you actually just send something to the server and it gives you back something else. So how do you express loading state? Because that's another thing. Well, you can snap a huge loading indicator spinner on it, but what React did is actually a lot more, it's actually clever, but it's still kind of weird. They use suspense, which utilizes quite controversial aspect of JavaScript that you can throw errors from everywhere, and errors can be anything. So you can throw promises, and those promises will be caught during the render phase. And when you caught, when the renderer caught a promise, this is the new Fiber renderer, by the way, when it caught a promise, it's going to halt the update of the subtree and wait for the data to come in, and then render the rest of the subtree. One thing I did not talk about, by the way, is that React did not start out with this with the Fiber renderer. First, it had the renderer that had to do the whole thing every single time. It was rewritten in like 2014-ish and onwards. How do you preserve state on the page? You diff stuff. That's all. You just take the virtual DOM, see if what's on the actual DOM and on the virtual DOM is different, and there you have it, you can sync it back. And also, how do you respond instantly? I don't want to wait for my phone to send a comment so that I can scroll a bit more on Instagram or Facebook or TikTok or whatever. Well, we can use concurrency. Concurrent mode lets you interact with your app in ways that were not possible before. You had to wait for the request response to go out and come in. For any framework of your choice, be it plain HTML, CSS, JavaScript, or Angular, or Svelte, or Solid, or HTMX, or whatever these days, you may want to be able to answer these questions that I just posed, because they are paramount to your customer's success, to your website's behavior. And it's actually really, really good for you to think about these questions, like how would you solve them? What do you see as the benefits and Oops, yeah, that was the, okay. So what do you see as the benefits of the solutions from Angular? For example, I don't use too much Angular, I mostly use React, and this one is actually just HTML. So I don't really use too much Angular, but I actually started recommending Angular in cases where somebody just doesn't know what to do, and but it's actually still the whole package. You don't have to think about how you're gonna do state management. You don't have you don't have to decide between Redux or signals or whatever thing. Angular has everything. For example, for HTMX, you have plain HTML and some interactivity, syntactic sugar splashed in. You don't really write JS with that. So most of these frameworks have answers to these questions, and these frameworks actually push everything forward. For example, with web components, what we have now is that browsers actually started supporting a core feature of these frameworks. You can now create components, and you don't really need to install Angular or React for that. You can just import those components from plain JS with a few lines of code. So yeah, I would like to actually encourage you to be curious about these things. If you encounter a bug, if you see some weird behavior, like with this one, actually, I'm just gonna show you because it was so frustrating. There's this gigantic React logo here, and I set it to rotate for like 200 seconds and do a full rotation. And when I started scrolling it in Chrome, what started to happen, it started jumping around really crazy because it has a mandatory scroll. And what happens is, apparently, the Chrome renderer treats these rotations as changes in some scroll behavior, whatever. You can get to the bottom of this, like deleting codes line by line, stepping through the debugger, and just see what the hell happens. Like, why do these bugs happen? Why do some features actually work? And what variables go through each one of those? In the end, I just opted to not include the animation. This is actually something that you might want to take as a, I think it's a pretty good advice, say no. If something really doesn't seem to work out and you have absolutely no idea, just, yeah, I don't know. I'm just not gonna make a spin. Yeah, but in the end, if you have a library, you have a bug, like something doesn't work the way you know it should work, just look into it, like why? What assumptions is this library making that are actually different from what I thought it would be making? Like, for example, I don't know if you knew, but async await is pretty slow compared to callbacks. And that's due to the way generators actually work nowadays. So yeah, if you read a lot of these things, I'm not saying I understand a lot of this, but the more I look into it, the deeper I look, I'm just gonna have to trust my brain to do the thing, to do the work for me, and put together these small pictures, these small aspects of all these things that I'm gonna be able to eventually make a mental model that I can build upon to be able to write in, I don't know, what is it now, 15 different languages and I don't know how many platforms and all that stuff. I'm just gonna go in, like YOLO, whatever. I'm gonna screw it up. I'm gonna screw it up a lot of times. I'm gonna do unnecessary refactors. I'm gonna write spaghetti code. But in the end, I'm gonna be better for it. I'm gonna know a lot more about what I'm doing and what I need to be doing next time I come to the same problem. And next time I need to come to a decision. Yeah, also don't do this at work. Like, maybe the debugger part, but the exploration. Like, for example, this one, I never used HTMX before and Alpine.js, and this website is interactive via Alpine.js. You can't tell because these dots are all dynamic and the coloring is dynamic, and I did not write too much JS for that. But I never did that before. And these sort of things are what actually let you expand on your horizons beyond your work, but they do transfer to your work, and they do transfer to your everyday life as well. You don't want to be like Randy in the South Park episode, I think 2 weeks ago, where he was like, let's fix the oven. Okay, hey, repairman, fix my oven. I can't fix the oven. And yeah, so stay curious. We're going to move on to a really interesting new technology that I encourage you to actually read the source code, because it's not that much. And that's going to be server components from my great colleague, Daniel.